this one this way?
Yes, please. So we're good?
Yes, we are.
Okay. All right, if I could have everybody's attention. Good evening. This is the Village of New Paltz Planning Board meeting, Tuesday, May 3rd, 2016. We have a pre-application tonight, PB 1609 at 85 North Chestnut Street in the MBR district. We have a new site plan application at 56 Plains Road, PB 1610. An ongoing application, PB 1608 at 5 Mulberry Street. We have a discussion about a specific zoning document that's been being worked on for many months now, part of 212-23, and we have several administrative business things, minutes and so forth. So that's it. We'll start with public comment tonight if anybody has any specific comments. Miriam?
Hi.
Miriam, if you, just for the television viewing audience.
Yeah, state your full name so I'm
clear.
Thanks. Hi. Thanks for the opportunity. My name is Miriam Strauss. I live at 143 Huguenot Street, rather close to the neighborhood business residential district, and I have some concerns about Zero Place that I think you've heard before, but I just wanted to put them on the record again. I have some concerns about the proposed location of the stormwater management infrastructure, who would be maintaining it, who would be paying for it, and what property is it on. I'm also concerned about the number of parking places, both being inadequate, although they conform to the mandates of the new district, and spilling onto the adjacent streets, and also a question of whether they would be able, as of right, to use all the places that would have been in use, or the area that would have been in use for parking at the former park and ride, given that that has been out of service since the beginning of the year. So I, my understanding is there's some legal questions about that that I'd love to see clarified. But beyond that, particularly being a person with the curse of unusually acute hearing, I'm very concerned about the possible use of the tenants on an upstairs deck, given that I was looking at the noise ordinances for the village and, quote, no noise from parties, entertainment, music, or social gatherings of any kind, I'm deleting a little, shall be heard inside any residence adjacent to the source of the noise when you've closed your doors and windows. Well, that's all fine and dandy, except for the fact that when do you party on the roof? During the seasons when your neighbors are more likely to have their doors and windows open. So admittedly, that's when you would have tree cover, but because of the proposed height of this building, I don't know how much of a buffer it would be to noise. So these are just some of my concerns, but I wanted to get them on the record. Thank you.
Thank you, Mary. Other public comment? Okay, go ahead, Bob.
I'm against this new building for a variety of reasons. I've lived at 100 Court up in Huguenot for 35 years, so I've seen things happen. Stewarts wanted to build there, which has been a very good thing. The reason being, you know, I've gone to Stewarts every day for 35 years. Every day they get lots of people there, a lot of people looking for food who leave with a bag or two of food. And it's a very useful food outlet for both eating ice cream and getting things you need for supper. And then usually there are lines there. And then also inside they have, I think, three or four places to sit, but they could use more. Sometimes it's difficult to park there because their parking lot is rather small. So people who may be coming to go there may not get in or create a parking problem. But if Stewarts were to have built in the new area, they'd get much more parking. It would enhance the size of the store and the amount of food and the varieties of food. And that would have helped a number of people who live in the area buy food. That way you don't have to go to ShopRite. So they sell a tremendous amount of food. They could sell more if they have a larger store and if they would have a larger selection of food. So again, I think a problem of building this place is the parking for the people. And if they're going to be stores below, where are you going to park to go into the store? I don't know whether they would try to come down towards Huguenot Park or whatever. But my prime concern is that Stewart's was not allowed to build there. And they did a great deal of benefit by serving more people. And I know that some of the same people every day would come by to buy food for the home. So I'm sure if they were bigger, they would sell more. And aid these people. These people will have to go to ShopRite. So that's about all I'll say.
Thank you, Bob.
Can I have your name?
Robert Presby, P-R-E-S-B-I-E.
Thank you.
Thank you. Any other public comment for this evening?
Yes.
If you want to use, yeah, it would be good actually that, if you don't mind, just for the television. Thanks.
Sit.
You can sit too. You can stand. Other way.
My name is Richard Webb, and I live at 20 Cooper Street in the Green Acres development just up the hill. I by no means am an expert in town history or zoning laws. I speak mostly from a vantage point of interest and excitement in the new zoning law that allows for a certain type of development in the town that I think is good for the town, that will allow for the town to grow in a dense way and a smart way that prevents sort of further sprawl. I think our goal is to have the town grow in a way that allows for continuous walking within the downtown area, and I think that's just part of, if we recognize that New Paltz will be growing, and that's healthy for tourism and healthy for the many small shop owners who are here, like Stewart's, I think we want to allow it to grow in a way that has more of a dense center, and I think some taller buildings will be necessary. I hope that it's done in a way that abides by the zoning, and I think there's some wisdom in the way the zoning was done, and I would hope that those existing laws are enough to keep people like the neighbors in Huguenot comfortable in their current homes once it's built. So that's my thought. Thank you.
Thank you.
Anybody else for public comment? I know.
Yeah, I'm the first thing I can.
Okay. Neighborhood. I don't think we should be putting anyone down because
because you want to build something new. I think the things that we need in our neighborhood are things like my father spoke about. We could use a grocery store that's affordable. The one we have is not affordable down the road on the end of Montecue. Most people can't afford to shop there. Right now, we drive uptown. If we're looking to stop people from driving uptown and using cars, we could have a smaller, more affordable grocery store in our area. We could have a pharmacy in the NBR district. We don't need little coffee shops or things like that. We need the services. We could use doctor's offices, not four-story, 48-unit doctor's offices, but small little facilities that those in our neighborhood could frequent instead of driving uptown, which I believe we're talking about is the whole point here, that we don't want people getting into cars to go places. Well, of course, we have to get into a car to go places, but it'd be better to go closer instead of farther. A four-story building with additional things on the roof will be visible from Henry Court. The picture in the paper shows it above the tree line. There is no reason to make any exceptions in the zoning law for this building. No reason whatsoever, and I expect everyone on the planning board not to make any exceptions. I also expect everyone in the village to think about this zoning that may have come in and may have been put in the paper and may have been talked about in some places, but realize that not everyone had an opportunity to come to meetings at that point and point out why that shouldn't be there or why they were unhappy with it. Just because a couple of people put it through doesn't mean that we are happy with this NBR zoning. Some of us couldn't come to meetings because of health reasons. Some of us couldn't even drive a car at that point and get out to these meetings. Clearly, it was just a point of getting things down in the daily life. Not everyone can make it here. But this whole zoning, if we let this go up, it's going to affect all neighborhoods, Montecue, Henry Court, Huguenot Street, Mulberry Street. It's already very difficult to get out with the car from Montecue onto North Chestnut. It's very difficult with the car to get out from Mulberry Street onto North Chestnut. We're adding 48 units, possibly double that number of people that are living there, and people visiting these buildings, and all those cars. And we haven't put in any plans for lights in that section. We haven't talked about slowing down the speed limit, which people are zooming through more than 30 in that spot because they're coming from 40 on northern section of the village on 32. And clearly that's a county or state Idaho County Road right there. We're not responsible, but we can apply for things like lowering the speed limit in that area, particularly if you're going to be having all these cars there, putting in a stoplight. We can't expect to put this in without those modifications, and I don't think anything should go through until all that has been discussed. It will be a huge impact with cars. Also, these solar panels that are going to be facing the north side will be visible from Henry Court, and light will be glaring off them. That is in no way, shape, or form a good idea for anyone that's going to be able to see those. We're going to be seeing light from the solar panels, lights from the windows there, noise, the cars, the fumes. It's going to directly affect all of the neighborhoods surrounding it. I really urge you to step back and deal with this with caution, to look at every little bit, decide this is really what we need. Do we need parties on the rooftop? Do we need solar panels directing sunlight into other neighborhoods? Right into our front windows, which face that direction? Absolutely not. We need to eliminate any rooftop venue in the NBR district. We need to change our zoning so that there's nothing that can happen on the rooftop. We need to lower it to two stories. What we have now is two stories that all fits in, blends in, is fine. As I said, this is a building that we wouldn't want in any other location in the village of New Paltz. Why would we put it in this quote NBR district? Why would any building be that large in the NBR district? We have plenty of apartment buildings. We already have a huge apartment complex just feet, literally feet from where Zero Space is going to be put in. We have Southside apartment buildings. We have the other ones that I can name off.
Could you wrap it up, please?
Why?
Because
there's no one else that wants to do public comment.
Because we have a meeting and we'd like to hold public comment to about 3 minutes per person. No, there's no such thing as 30 minutes for public comment. It's typically 15 minutes. And I just ask that each person respect that all of us as volunteers here are, we have a meeting, we have applicants in front of us, and you've said quite a few things, and I've taken some notes. If you have something else that you would like to say that's different from what you've said, just please wrap it up. You're also always welcome to put your comments in writing. We will all get copies, and we will certainly, we are taking all of these comments very seriously. So I just ask that you wrap it up, that's all.
Okay, to sum up, New Paltz is no place for zero space.
Thank you.
Oh, I'm sorry, what is your name?
Annette.
Nell, and your last name?
Presby. Thank you.
Anybody else for public comment? Yes, sir.
I'm going to keep my comments a bit briefer. My name is Barry Goldshine. I live in the neighborhood as well, just a couple of blocks up from the corner of 32 and Henry DeBoyd. And I was excited about the project from the start because I think it's the kind of construction that we'd be looking for in the town. We've always supported renewable energy, and it's at that. I've appreciated taking the comments that I've heard and that I've seen written in the Times, and I know that there are a number of concerns, some of them legit, some of them I think a little less legitimate. The zoning's been done for a reason. I think the building fits the purposes of the zoning. I also have a little bit of concerns with the way it's currently proposed. I just wanted to encourage the board to encourage this kind of development and to work with the developers that are coming to you and for approval on these kinds of plans, work with them to address concerns to an extent to make these kind of projects happen.
Thank you.
What is your address? I'm sorry.
Perry Goldshine, G-O-L-D.
No, your address?
Oh, an address, I'm sorry. 10 Caramel Way.
Thank you.
Any other people for public comment? No? All right, hearing none. Thank you all very much for, hold on one second, I'm just making some notes. Thank you very much for speaking, everybody. I really appreciate it. I think the board is very interested in hearing what the public has to say about this or any other project. So that is why we provide public comment. You can be assured that as this projects go forward, there are legal processes that also in which there are public hearings, which are on a bit more formal in terms of the way that we record those comments and then put them into our minutes. They may not be, these may be a bit more abbreviated. In any event, again, thank you all very much. You want to help him?
Yes.
Okay. All right, we're going to do a pre-application for PB 1609. You guys would come up. You want to come to the table? Roger? Yeah.
Did we get anything on this? Did we get any kind of maps?
All we got was his application.
Application.
And at Christina's request, we got that Google Earth marked up and then David's comments. Hi, how are you?
Hi, I'm good. My name is Roddy Serda. I'm here for a change of use from for the 85 North Chestnut.
Okay, so why don't you tell us a little bit about what you would like to do on the property?
I'd like to do used car sales on a small scale, nothing big, and the repair for those cars and get them ready, detail them, clean them up, and make them, you know, safely ready for sale.
Okay.
Well, you know, we're hoping to, it's already been, the building was there before with the, as a body shop. So it has existing overhead doors. Mm-hmm. It has existing entrance and exit. And, you know, we're going to keep it as minimal as possible, like maybe 10 or 12 cars in the parking lot. It's not going to be any huge, you know, usage. Mm-hmm. That's what we're trying to do with it. We're not going to change any structures of the building. We're just going to clean it up, you know, on the outside and the inside, and make a nice showroom for used cars, and maybe one lift or something inside to work on the cars we sell. Mm-hmm. No inspection, you know, to the public or repairs. It's going to be just in-house repairs for the cars we sell.
So you understand that the zoning has changed significantly in this area?
Yes.
And I believe the zoning had become the current zoning before you purchased the property. If it wasn't, it was the North Chestnut Gateway District, which was already quite different from the Highway B3 business before that. So there are a number of things, as I understand it, that are required that this property at the moment doesn't comply with. Parking needs to be in on the side or the rear of the building, wherever possible, not in the front of the building.
Buildings, it's on the side. There's plenty of parking on the side.
Yep.
Between Mulberry and the building.
There is some, it's true. The building needs to be multi-use. It needs to be a minimum of 2 stories.
Yeah, but we're not changing the building.
It doesn't matter. The zoning has changed.
Yeah, so, but it's zoned, what I understood from them, it's zoned for automotive sale and
that's correct.
Automotive repairs.
That's correct. But the buildings, those, okay. Unless you intend to go for a variance, the zoning requires that all buildings in this district be a minimum of 2 stories. There are a couple of exceptions for certain nonprofit uses, cultural buildings or civic buildings, but not for general business use.
Yeah, but I don't want to build anything on top of it, or I'm not in a
I know, but
position to build or change any structural
so
on the building.
So this may not have been the building that you should have purchased. I can't tell you about
so
that.
What can I do with the building the way it is now? Or what?
Well, you would have to get a variance.
You would have to go to the Zoning Board of Appeals and request a variance, and you'd have to explain why, and they will give you a specific set of criteria. One of the things is it can't be a self-imposed hardship. That is, it can't be that you did something like purchase the building and with an awareness of what the zoning
is.
Yeah,
when I purchased the building, I was aware that it is zoned for repair shop and for automotive sale, and that it, nobody said that you have to change, you know.
I'm not sure who you spoke to when you say nobody told you, but
I know they changed the zoning to NBR.
Yes.
And you have to have multi-use.
That's correct.
But you don't, that's mean you have to knock it down and build a building that to do a multi-use, or put a second story or third story.
Right.
To make it.
There is precedent. I mean, the Village Pizza a number of years ago, when it was still B3 actually, took a garage and turned it into a 2-story building.
Yeah.
I can't tell
you. But I'm not in a position to tell
you. No, that's fine. And it's not my.
It's not everybody could, you know, just go out there and.
I understand.
Right.
So what I would suggest that you do, and I don't mean to dominate the conversation. I just want to sort of set the table here. I'll let these guys talk too. I suggest that you look at the zoning as it's currently in place and read all of the details, because there are a number of things that have to happen in terms of the intent is to, over a period of time, improve the infrastructure along the streets for these buildings, which means that We're hoping over time to get sidewalks in, to get street trees in, to get this building, this particular lot has no curbs in front of it whatsoever. And I can tell you we would press pretty hard to get curbs installed and with specific curb cuts so that you didn't have just this huge expanse of pavement that runs right into the shoulder of the road as it currently is. And so there are a number of site improvements that you would be asked or required to do if you choose to put this use in. But at the very least, I strongly suggest that you read through it, the zoning code. You're welcome to sit down with the building inspector and talk to him. I can try, one of us can, you know, if it comes to a point where you would also like to meet with a planning board member while you're meeting with the building inspector or our planner, we can certainly try to arrange for somebody to meet, to have that. You're certainly welcome to meet with David Gilmore, our village planner, and the building inspector after you've read the zoning carefully. And then if you are committed to what it is you want to do and it doesn't meet the zoning, then you'll have to apply for a variance. And then the Zoning Board of Appeals will decide whether or not it makes sense to grant you that variance to go ahead and do what you want to do.
I guess we'll go to the...
But first I suggest that you carefully read the zoning, make sure you understand it. Our planner, our building inspector, and planning board members are here to try to help you achieve what you want, but you have to understand that the zoning was designed a certain way in order to try to, not to eliminate auto sales, but to try to incorporate them into a different design of a district and a neighborhood that is not 40,000 square feet minimum highway business dominated, which is what it's been since the mid-70s. So auto sales are allowed, but the structure of the sites are what's required is different now. Anyway, comments from anybody else?
Yeah, I think, you know, planning board is sometimes people confuse what we do. Okay. We're really here to implement the law that's in place. We're here to help show that your plans are in compliance with the law. So to be able to change the law, that's not our position, that's his board's position. That's the village board, that's his board's position. It takes the village board to change the law. Or the ZBA. You go to the ZBA and ask that you get a variance and not have to comply. But you have to meet certain criteria to do that. And if we put your proposal up against the current MBR zoning, you'd need a list of changes, not just one or two.
And to get variances?
Yeah.
And
it wouldn't be just one change. I mean, you need changes from the height restriction, you need changes from the use restriction, you need changes on the setback, you need changes. You have so many changes that would be needed. I can't tell you that the ZBA can or won't grant them. That's their job. I can tell you that we can't change the law to do it.
So the way the building is, what can I do with it the way it is?
What you could do, what you can do is exactly what it is.
Right, okay? as is.
What you could do is exactly what it is. Any change to what it currently is going to require meeting the, and I might be wrong on this, meeting the restrictions and meeting the all the requirements under the NBR zone.
So if it was to continue as an auto parts store,
well, auto parts is not necessarily, it's
a retail
store.
Exactly, retail store, then you can continue with it as it is.
As much as we may not like it from terms of fitting our grand plan and scheme of things, my reading of the law would be that it's got a continuance of use if that's what he chose to do. But auto sales is not a retail use.
But the retail use, you could use it the way as is.
Well,
I'm just...
Rich, no, I understand. Rich may be right. I think...
But that's what they make lawyers over.
Right, exactly. Yeah. I think before we give you a definitive answer on that, we would have to get an opinion from our attorney about two aspects. One is it as broad as any retail use? Because, okay, so there are a couple of issues in this zone. One is that in general, we, with one exception, we tried to eliminate broad sort of retail categories, and we specified specific uses. The exception to that is the limited business use, which is defined in our zoning code, and it covers quite a variety of retail uses. The second thing that you should be aware of, and again, this comes back to making sure you read the code carefully and understand it, and talk with our staff members, planning, our planner and our building inspector. Every use in the district is a special use permit. There is no as-of-right use. So the planning board has to make a determination about whether a use is there. So there is a list of uses.
Okay.
If it's not on that list, it is prohibited. So for example, bars are prohibited in the NBR district. But if a use is on there and you want to bring it forward, the planning board still has to consider, based on various criteria, whether or not that's going to be allowed under that particular, in that, on that, for that particular application, meaning at that particular site. So I think at this point your best bet is to carefully read the code again and work with our building and planning department to see what your options are.
Okay.
When you come with a list of questions, we will be happy to get, if we need legal
advice
on it, we'll be happy to give you, you know, we'll do that and get some answers that will help give you at least some choices about what avenues you want to go down. And the Zoning Board of Appeals might be one. There might be others that will open up as you start these conversations. So, other thoughts?
No.
Rich?
No.
Bill? Okay. So,
okay.
All right.
Thank you.
Okay,
thank
thanks.
You. Yeah. Thank you, guys.
All right. Take care. Have See you day. Again. Okay, so next we have PB 1610, 56 Plains Road, if you guys would like to come up. Hi, Dennis.
Hi.
You want to come up, Paul? Okay, so I hope there is no confusion among people here, since we actually have, it's not confusing to you, but to this board, we actually happen to have two applications on Plains Road, and Brooks and Brooks are the surveyors for both of them.
For both of them.
So,
yeah.
So, yeah, it wouldn't be surprising if it got confusing. So, this application is a site plan application for a new home construction and shed at 56 Plains Road. Okay. So you guys want to give us a little background?
Yeah, sure. As you know, we live on both, we have the other lots on either side.
Right.
And we've always liked to have our own house. We'll live in that by ourselves. As Christina knows, we have dogs, so I'd like to have plenty of fencing for the four Airedales.
Mm-hmm.
And at first, you know, we said we subdivided a few years back.
Right.
And the thought was, well, maybe we'll put a house up or maybe we'll sell it. And then over time, we realized that if we sell it, those people are going to be our neighbors. And you're never 100% sure, you know, what you're going to get. So we decided, at that point, let's just keep the property for ourselves. And originally, we were going to put it up on 40, but then the zoning changed. So we said, okay, you know, maybe things happen for the best. Because the 56 is a nice 3.6 acre parcel. And of course, we'll be right in the middle, so we know who's on either side of us. And that's basically it. It's a one-family house, 1,300 square feet, and that's where we're going.
Okay. So, you guys have specific questions, comments? If you want to take a minute, I could start. It's up to you. All right, I'm going to start. Okay, so what we have is we have your application, we have your building plans, and we have the site plan, which you've modified
right
in order to show us where things are, and we have a memo from our planner. So I have a couple of questions. Are there any improvements on the site, on the lot at the moment?
A while back we put in a septic.
Okay.
It has the D-tank and it has the septic field.
Okay.
And we have a driveway, and then we also just cleared the property.
Okay.
Not, you know, mostly just taking down some small.
Okay. So the location of the proposed septic and reserve as shown on this are...
I have in here the approval from, you know, Chris Kresser and all of that.
So that's all DOH approved.
Yeah.
And then the driveway is shown here is says proposed, but you've actually put
a while ago. Actually, sometimes I'd go down there and park my truck. So we had Dan Ingram come and he made a small drive. It's maybe only 50 feet at most.
Okay, so you're going to expand the driveway then?
Not a lot, you know, a little bit maybe, but not a lot.
Okay. So you have DOH approval. So tell us about the landfill.
Okay, and that's why...
Give us this interesting history.
give you $40,000 worth of it.
Yeah.
We moved to New Paltz from Warwick.
Okay.
And at that time, we bought 58 Plains Road, and there was this adjacent parcel. And quite frankly, we really didn't even know much about it. The Millams didn't say a heck of a lot. And we said, you know, that's fine. Back then, around 2000, 2001, we decided we would go put up a house. My son was in SUNY New Paltz. My daughter was going to Marist. So we figured, well, this will work out. He wound up going to Japan, and she went to Jersey City. But so we put that house up. But
I may have to cut you a little short, Dennis.
Yeah.
I can't get your whole family.
Okay. So we got approval from Allison Murray, and we had the foundation in. And then all of a sudden, DEC came along and stopped it.
Okay.
Someone had said that we couldn't do it. And this was after we had, you know, our building application.
Sure.
Well, I'll keep it brief. We've had Bob Hagopian. We've had the DEC. We have one here with all the pictures that we dug 21 holes. There's nothing there.
Oh, so you did bore tests. Okay.
Yeah, I can leave that. We dug all over to try to find something. All you'll find, and by the way, it was run by the village.
Mm-hmm.
It was like a forerunner of a recycling center.
Okay.
So you'll go there and you'll see tin cans or you'll see glass. But there's no, like, drums of toxic anything. And by the way, it was closed in April of 1960.
Okay.
So it's been, and we've been living there for 20 years. So, and we want to continue to live there.
Right.
So there's nothing dangerous, but we have a whole system of foundation, like a radon system that has to be put in. This is what we did in 40.
Mm-hmm.
It's basically a manifold with holes on top of stone, and if there were any kind of gases.
So the DEC has it, I mean, based on this, they have to approve?
They approved it already.
And they have for, do they have to do it again for your current building envelope?
The only thing we'd have to do is, and I talked to him, thank goodness he's back in his own practice, is Bob Hagopian might have to come and you know, sign off on the foundation.
I mean, and I talked to the building inspector today about it, and he'll certainly be, he understands the situation. He'll certainly be looking at, as you're putting footings in, he'll be looking to make sure that he doesn't see any signs of, that would raise concerns.
Yeah.
In terms of, you know, the soil profile and so forth. Okay, so I just want to be clear. So DEC doesn't, is not, because based on this, I just want to make sure that I understand this right. You had said, does the proposed action require a permit approval or funding from any other government agency? And you listed the DEC as well as the County Board of Health.
Yeah.
So.
Do you have a copy of that, of what the DEC approved?
Yeah.
Yeah, we got that. I think we got that in our packet. We have a letter from August 2008 from the DEC.
Okay.
And then we have a second letter that's from 2004 or 2007. It says 04. Okay. So, about a year apart, two letters.
Yeah, the big one is here on August 18th.
Yeah. Okay.
The department is satisfied.
Right.
We had, and I think so, I have a copy. Seven, yeah, this
I just wanna,
seven things that we had to conform.
I just want to be clear. I mean, we'll have a conversation about SEAKER a little bit later, but if the DEC is not, does not actually have to give a permit or approval,
no.
Then we'll just correct this because.
Oh, you mean I checked it
you
off?
You checked
wrong.
It.
Oh, okay.
So I mean, it is correct that the DOH has to give approval,
right?
But I think, in general, what this refers to is not things that have happened in the past and for which. Is that fair to say? I mean, if DEC gave approval 10 years ago for something, there's no reason to indicate on SEAKER that they still have to give approval. Am I reading it correctly?
DEC's compliance framework is that the past approval is your approval.
Yeah.
In this case, it's been shown that there's two permits or approvals needed from Board of Health and from DEC on the environmental assessment.
Right.
So if you have permits in hand, do you need to show them, in a sense, an uncoordinated action? I would say yes, you need to show them.
Okay. All right.
But I haven't checked the manual on that before.
All right.
Making that
so
observation.
Maybe we'll leave it as it is. It's fine. I mean, you have you have the approvals as well, so that's fine. So. Okay, you had indicated that you have on your site plan where you're proposing to build the house, but you've indicated that you might like to have a sort of a larger envelope.
When I talked to Brian, he said, he told me to do that. He said, you mean where it says move 50 feet? Or
something? Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, he said, well, look, maybe when we start, you know, we're going to be in the same place. I'm not going to move it 200 feet away. He said, if for some reason, you have to move it a little to the left, put it to the right, put that in there.
Uh-huh.
And that way the planning board will know that, you know, it is something that could be considered.
Okay, so Brian suggested that?
Yeah.
Okay.
And just as long as I'm on that subject, Mike, I don't think we're putting up the barn right away or the shed.
Okay.
But again, he said, if you're thinking about doing this in the next 2 years or something like that, put it down. That way, at least the planning board knows that you're not coming in with something up in the back door. So,
yeah,
but,
no,
but
then
this, when, I don't really think we're going to do that now.
So, since you brought that up, one of the code issues is that our code does not allow accessory buildings to be between the street and the front line of your main residence. Do you have a problem relocating the shed?
No, it's really going to be like more of a workshop
That's
type
what
of
I
thing.
Look like.
Yeah.
Okay, good. All right, so then what we would like then is on the next version of this plan just to indicate a different location. So in other words, the issue is, it doesn't have to be behind the house, but it, so if this is the house and here's the street and we draw a line parallel through the front edge of the house,
okay.
Ideally you'd like it to be behind that line.
Oh, okay.
That's
so
all.
You can't have anything in the front of the house and
right.
to the street.
Right.
All
so,
outside.
You know, so you'd like to, if you can put it here, I mean, if you really
exactly.
want it by your driveway, because that's convenient,
yeah.
and, you know, put it there.
Oh, okay.
You know, and if your house it ends up being in this circle, you know, then think about that. Obviously, if it comes closer, it's an issue. If it goes behind, if your house ends up way back here, then you might want to reconsider citing the.
Okay.
That's all.
Yeah.
You have plenty of room. It's not an issue, but.
So we saw the design by okay. the same architect, and we said that's a neat-looking building, so why don't we just put it in there? But,
okay, yeah so we'd like to have it on the plan.
Sure.
It means you won't have to return to us if the whole plan gets approved, yep. and you choose to put that in at a later time. The building inspector is the only person you'll need to talk okay. to about that.
Is that going
to
be plumbed, water and sewer with the barn?
The barn?
Yeah. The shed, yeah.
I don't really know. You know, it's kind of probably at this point. Maybe I'd like water in there or something. But for right now, it's not kind of far in the future. We just we don't have with the house. You can see we don't have a garage. We don't really yeah. need a garage. I have a lot of tools and a lot of stuff that I'd like to have okay. separate from the house.
Well, the only thing is I wanted to point out is that I didn't want it to be. Approved the same time as the house because I didn't want a CO dependent on both buildings being completed at the same time. Because we don't have the money to do both.
I understand.
You know,
that's fine.
Get the house done.
Yeah, that's fine. And we can indicate in the approval that there's a, you know, we can put a note in that indicates that we're approving this site plan, that there's some indeterminate time, you know, we'll figure it out.
Conform to your standard.
Yeah, and the problem is if you don't put it on this plan and then you decide to build it later, you have to come back
well,
in front
that's
of us
said,
all over
yeah.
again and have another public hearing.
Okay.
And I don't think this board, you know, it doesn't, you're not creating a situation that I think is problematic by choosing to do this. And so we'll just make okay. sure that it's clear that they're not codependent. You can
okay.
get your CO to
okay.
move in.
Yeah, great.
Good.
Thanks.
Thanks.
We just did that on a recent
yeah, you did.
Yes. I went very near and dear to my heart, by
yeah.
the way. But.
His house. Yeah. Okay. Yes, the lot is in the 100-year floodplain, as you've correctly indicated,
yeah.
but the building envelopes are nowhere near that. That's all on the south.
Right.
Eastern part of the property. Okay. So that's not a problem. And there was one other item I had highlighted, which was the landfill, and we've discussed that. Okay. So other people?
You're missing a couple little minor things.
Oh, well, I'm sorry.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Will Toho be required in the next round?
Why?
5 p.m.
What we ask for usually is 2-foot topos of the land to show the elevation changes in the land. But for the most part, this lot is flat, especially in the area where he's looking to build.
Yeah.
Are you planning to change the grade where you build significantly?
Not really.
Okay.
You can request from us then to be exempted from the topo
right.
requirement.
So you can request a waiver.
Yeah, because you know it's a slab. I mean, it's not.
Oh, you're building on. Okay.
But you got to request yeah. it. Before we can say anything.
So what do we have to do now? Request that?
We just need a letter to requesting that you be exempt from the topos.
From the topos?
Yeah.
The other thing is you've got to show the water line. You're going to use village water, I assume?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's right there.
You
lucky show it's on that side of the...
You got to show the water line going to the structure.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, again, it's proposed, so...
We need to show the placement of the septic.
Here you go.
No, because he's got a septic system, that's built by the county.
Sorry, it's...
So, Rich, just show the where the water line is going to come in.
Yeah.
Okay.
You're guessing at this point.
Yeah.
It's not hooked up yet.
Yeah. That is the house.
Would we address the letter to you?
Just address the letter to the planning
to
board,
the,
requesting
to
that
the
you
village
be exempt from producing 2-foot topo maps.
Yeah.
You got to show the water line coming in.
Right.
You really should show
the
building setbacks are in compliance, even though we can see from the size of this lot, it doesn't take a genius to realize. You're more than 12 and a half feet from your sidelines.
So what do you,
you
want me
should
to
be able
put the
to
actual
show
feet?
The building setbacks.
Just so
okay.
Since Brian suggested that you put, I'm gonna just add
yeah.
to that. Since Brian suggested that you put an envelope, a building potential envelope around where you might build the house.
Okay.
It would probably be a good idea if you've drawn the proposed house. If
right.
you could draw, say, a radius around the center of the house.
Okay.
And then add to that a dotted line that would show the setbacks from the side and the front.
Okay. And how big of a radius, Mike?
Whatever you and Brian talked about, the, okay. the note said 50 to 75 feet.
Oh, you mean for the, okay.
Potentially.
Right. Yeah, okay.
So you're building, you're putting a 1,300 square foot house in. It's, you know.
Well, and what I would say for pretty certain, it's not going towards the street.
Okay.
I kind of put it, you know, where it is because that's where the septic is.
Okay. Well,
so
then,
I'll do what you said. I'll put that.
So maybe not a radius, but define in some way and identify an area within which this building
could
will go.
Shift. Okay.
Obviously bigger than the footprint, and then.
We have lots where every foot matters.
Yeah.
You've
got
so much setback. Yeah. But you got to show it on the map.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. My only concern
just show us the setbacks on the map.
Sure.
Yeah. My only concern would be the. The southern lot line against your, what is it, 58?
Yeah.
Which one? The southern is 58. Right?
Yeah, so that, I mean, if you bring your building way close to that, you might.
It's
12 and a half feet or something?
12 and a half feet, so he's got plenty of
room. You've got plenty of room. Yeah.
I've just, you know, more was like when I talked to Brian, it was, you know, if let's say you. A boulder or something, you know, and he says, well, instead of bringing somebody in to blast and get rid of a boulder, we might move 10 feet. That was all.
That's fine.
Yeah, but just show us that building envelope meets all the setbacks.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay.
So no matter where you are in that building envelope, you're going to meet the setbacks.
When you're drawing it, if you have any questions, you can ask Bryant.
Okay.
You should put the width of the driveway at the road.
Okay.
I think the code states 12 feet.
12 feet minimum, 18 foot max.
Right.
Okay. I did have
12
Blue
to 18
come over
feet.
When he did it, but I will put that.
Yeah, just indicate.
And
what it
he
is.
Came over also to see the, you know, the clearance, the site of it.
Okay.
So, but you'll have to.
Just indicate on the site plan what the width
of it.
What
your
what width you'd like it to be.
Now, is any of this in the wetlands itself, or is it just an under your floodplain?
I don't.
Have you ever had it flagged for wetlands?
No.
I mean, my personal experience is that the wetlands are way to the eastern edge of it, because the land drops.
Well, off. The problem is if we look to our discovery, that your neighbor's in front of us. They're saying is what they have wetlands here.
At the back end of their property.
Okay.
If they've got wetlands here.
Right. You just want to know how far up they go.
Well, you should at least have it flagged and indicated on the map where the wetland areas are. You're not looking to build in it. You're not looking to be in it.
No, it's probably a good idea. You're right.
And what do you want?
But if you can just call the DEC, they'll come down and they'll flag the wetlands.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
They'll flag wetlands for you. And then your surveyor will just put her points on the map.
Okay.
Right.
I don't see where it's going to affect your building ability. It's just
no, but it is good to have
it's one of those eyes that we have to dot and
T
that we have to cross.
It says approximate stream and wet area.
Yeah.
The wet area could be synonymous with wetlands.
You don't know until the DEC takes a look at it.
Yeah.
I mean, you can go on land that's perfectly dry and it's wetlands because the vegetation of it supports wetland animals.
Yeah.
And so the DEC's definition
all
of
right,
wetlands
so
is not.
All right, so I'll call them and ask them.
Other things, Rich?
Now, you already brought the point up about the buildings.
I don't know if DEC will even take jurisdiction. I don't know that there's a DEC wetland on the site, but I think there was some NWI recommendation on GIS.
Okay.
Well, you know what? You're lucky. You've got the same surveyor. Ask Patty.
That's
she
a good thought.
This one next there.
Right.
Yeah.
Actually, yeah.
She may have this already done.
Okay.
Good point.
Just talk to Patty about it. Otherwise, no.
Okay.
Pretty straightforward after that.
Bill, you had started.
Just for maybe the back as well as ours, what happens to any sort of excavated material that's being removed from
site? Well, the DEC has a whole set of guidelines.
We have a whole set of guidelines. That, it has to be, can't leave the
site.
Leave
the property.
It's got to come out. And then, and that's why I say Hagopians go come down and make sure it has to, it has to come out, and then you have to put it back in, and then put topsoil on it.
So do you want those sort of management standards on your site plan when you get the next iteration?
It's probably good. Well, would that sort of thing typically be on, or is it more of a building department issue?
I would say it's more of a building department issue than it is a site plan planning board issue.
Okay.
So in terms of like change in topography or grade with fill or the health and safety characteristics of the management framework for DEC, if we're reviewing and approving a site plan, would we want that sort of notation on the plan so future users know about that, future planning boards, or should we not put it on?
I think the requirements for the DEC is written out, but you have a copy of that.
Yeah, I'm thinking maybe.
Do you want it actually on the map?
I mean, I wouldn't want that any more than I'd want the restriction if the health department puts on the septic system to be on there. I just view it as the same thing as the health department and the septic system. When you're dealing with putting a septic system on the property,
on the plan, then, you're saying,
you wouldn't normally put that on a site plan, but the health department wants in terms of the septic, the grade. Even if you were doing a 4-foot berm, you wouldn't put that on a site plan. You would have that be, you'd have to follow the rules and regulations of the health department in putting in the septic system. And in this case, he's got regulations to follow in terms of altering any digging on the site because of this former dump that was there. Or a landfill, or whatever it was.
Mm-hmm. Processing.
Well, the dump was at least one piece of paper.
I mean, when I remember being a kid going down there, it was mostly, we used to get the old bricks. And stuff.
Yeah, we had, actually in 58, the Millams took the bricks and built the fireplace.
Yeah, we
it's low, L-O-W-E,
yes.
Brickyard.
Yeah, if we got good low bricks, people would pay us for them, so we used to have to get bricks all the time.
Okay.
That's back when 12-year-olds made money.
Hooligans.
Rich Tudo.
I don't have anything new. I mean, all of the notes around barn, its usage, its position, this idea of the envelope versus the current location and its setbacks, water. I don't have anything new. I don't think,
okay.
I think it's all been addressed. And the, of course, the waste management, former use and the guidelines. And I think I agree with Rich that those guidelines are either static or will change by the DEC's requirements. So I'm not familiar with the requirement on the site plan. So I don't think I have anything new.
You have handwritten in stormwater detention up against Plains Road. What is?
I don't know. That's what when I sat down with Brian.
Yeah.
He said put something in there.
Why?
I don't know. He just said that was required. Just what is it for, Mike?
I don't know. That's why I'm asking.
How much of this is sand that's in there?
You know, that's a good question. You could dig here, and it's all clay, and I go 10 feet away, and it could be sand. The sand, like on 58, seems to be more to the back for some reason. Up close, like around where the house is, it's a combination of clay and sand.
No. I'll ask Blue and
do you have any specific...
understanding why he would do that.
I said in my analysis I was going to talk to DPW on Friday.
No, that's okay.
To do it today. I'm not presuming there's any like persistent wet area in the front of the lot.
Right.
So I didn't have a chance to talk to Blue.
Okay, so we'll get an answer to
that. Yeah,
we may
have the trench runs all the way down, and we have the culvert. Yeah. In the driveway. So.
All right, we'll find out. We might end up striking that from your plan.
There are no significant trees on the property.
There's some old trees in the back. I mean, anything
that. We're not really taking any trees down.
No, but you're supposed to note them on the site plan. Is anything that's. And then if Liz was here, she knows the numbers better than I do.
Yeah, certain calibers
really
and size.
The house. I mean, anything that's close to where we're going to put up the house, we can take down. We don't want them that close to the house. But they're not very.
What are you saying, Rich? Like trees you would want to make sure you didn't cut down? Or?
It's another I to be dotted and a T to be crossed. One part of our checklist says any trees of any significant size that are on the lot
should be noted.
Should just be identified on the site.
You mean the lot where the house is going?
Well, the whole property. So, I know, that's a lot.
Jeez.
I don't know. Well, let's ask about that.
It can be estimates along lines and not each identity.
Liz has served on that tree commission for a long time, too. She knows a lot about that.
And it, and
I mean, it's like funny, way in the back one corner there, there's like a dogwood. You wouldn't, I don't even know how that ever happened. Yeah. You get the white, but I mean, the other rich, this tree's all over, you know, locust trees. And
so it's really just a question of whether or not you need somebody like from the Shade Tree Commission to come out and identify them and mark them, and then Patty would just put them on the plan. It's not every tree.
Yeah.
Right.
But
they saw it some certain.
There's an area that you might be disturbed.
But we'll ask our planning board member who's absent, who serves on the.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
Who's on the? She'll know the details, and then we'll let you know.
Again, let me tell you how many building lots in the village of New Paltz are 3.6 acres.
Not a lot.
Yeah.
You may have the only one.
You might have the only one.
Nobody wanted this property.
Okay, so the next steps would be that there's one other item, which is about seeker. Normally, I mean, seeker says that the construction of a single family house is a type 2 action and it's exempt.
And I gave you a cite to that, correct?
Right. But we want to discuss this with our attorney because of the former landfill. Is that?
Well, that was a question. Do you want to? The question was whether there is, what are the management requirements with the development of this lot that link to DEC permit and approval? I think you, as a group, have said that you don't want that on the plan. So the question becomes whether this is a type 2 action.
Right.
Which it seems that it is, and you say that you make the finding that it's a type 2 action, and you're essentially done with seeker.
Right. So yeah. No, I realize. Like I know the process.
That's where you want to head.
Yeah. I think what I'm going to do, though, since you're going to submit a revised version of this plan, and we'll get you some answers to a couple of questions about the stormwater detention. And the issue about whether we need to indicate trees. You're going to have a few other things added as per the list that Rich proposed. So I don't think I'm going to do seeker tonight. One of the things I will do is ask our attorney, given the situation with the landfill and a DEC approval, whether we can just go ahead and list this as a type 2 action, in which case then we're done with seeker. Otherwise, it would be an unlisted action, and we'll just have to go through the short form and address some issues. It would just be a matter of us doing stuff at the table. It's not not going to change your outcome. So once we get, I mean, I guess our only other decision tonight would be. So we're not going to declare this a complete application because we need a revised site plan.
Right.
So my preference would be then. If we can get answers to your questions in the next day or so, and you can make changes to the plan, can you get these back to us by early next week, by Monday or something?
Yeah.
All right, then we could have you on the meeting of May 17th, although I can tell you it's going to be
a very... You said that's murder, right?
It's going to be a very busy meeting, so it just depends on how...
Well, it's up to you. I mean, we don't have... I don't have to go...
Well, the alternative would be to wait until the first meeting in June. And what... So the sequence would be, at our next meeting, assuming all of these issues are dealt with and they're on the site plan, we can... At that point, likely determine the application complete. We'll do seeker. We'll set a public hearing, which would be at the next meeting 2 weeks later. We hold the public hearing, unless there's some highly unusual discoveries. We should be able to wrap it up at that point.
All right. Well, we'll stay with the 17th then.
So I'm saying we could either finish the second meeting in June, or you could sit through a very long meeting on the 17th.
Let's do June.
Okay. So we'll, so in other words, we would see you in a month.
Okay.
That gives us a little more breathing room in terms of getting the answers and you getting your plan worked out. I think that's better anyway.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay? So then our objectives would be to have all of this, a new site plan with all of the changes from you back to Christina before May 17th, or no later than May 17th.
Okay.
So that gives us 2 weeks. Okay? So we'll get answers to you, then you can go ahead and do your part, return that to us, and then we would see you in June.
Okay, now just on the site plan, Mike.
Yes, sir.
When you say make the changes, what, I know that we have the list of changes to do, but.
Go ahead.
Can I take the, what do I do? Take the 12 copies back with me now and make the changes, or do you want me to get a whole new?
Right, because. So you're not actually, like, Patty isn't making these, you're doing these?
Yeah, I have a letter from her.
Okay.
It's in the packet. She said for this, it was okay, gave us approval to just put the location.
Okay.
You
know what? I think we're going to probably want Patty to actually do these so they're not just handwritten in.
All right.
Because some of the stuff we want to make sure that it's measured accurately. Okay. Not that I don't trust you, but I really, it would be better if we could pass this on.
Anyway.
Okay. Right.
So I'm going to ask her to just draw the, I'll show her where to do it, and then she'll draw it in.
And then she could do the wetland mapping.
Yeah, so we can, so, you know, you can sketch out the specific things, and again, if anything that you have on your list is unclear, you should contact Bryant, and he can help you ascertain, and, you know, if he needs to, he'll ask me or David, and we'll make sure that. So then you can give her a markup of all the things that need to be on there. She can always reach out and contact Christina.
It's actually what happened. I went to her to do this before I did, and she said, well, no, you just go ahead and do it. But I see what you're saying now. You got more involved.
Yeah, there's enough changes on it, I think. Okay. And because it's going to become an improved lot,
I
would rather that we have that. She can always call me or Christina if there's any questions. All right?
Sure.
Okay. Great.
Thanks very much.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks, everybody. Okay. Pete and Sylvia? Okay. So now we have PB 8, and I'm pulling up the wrong file. How are you guys?
Good.
So yeah, good.
Stop raining?
Not for a few days, I hear. Okay. Okay, so you guys have your foundation in. Thanks for doing that so efficiently. And so what we have that we want to discuss tonight, and you met with the Historic Preservation Commission.
Right. And Sylvia's going to meet with them again at some point to clarify, the treatments in terms of the colors. But everything else we discuss.
Okay, so maybe it would be good if you could give a very brief summary of the discussion you had with the Historic Preservation Commission and what you guys agreed to and what's still outstanding.
Okay, sure.
So if you could grab the mic, if you're going to be the one talking.
Actually, I don't know if you received a PDF of some of the changes that were made. They're small, but they requested that we change the transom window over the door on the west side. Okay.
That, I don't know if we got that.
They wanted us to make that a rounded transom, like a half circle type transom, rather than rectangular. And they wanted us to make all of the doors that have an arched top be the same door, because we had made one on that side of the building which was different than the two on the front.
Okay.
So we changed those things. You know, their biggest concern really was they were concerned about color. And so Sylvia's agreed to meet with them before, you know, submit something else before the next meeting, or meet with them at the meeting and come to, you know, an agreement. There's no...
Okay.
So, you know, she'll have to tell them that she's coming up with this other option and
All right, so you're making exterior changes
In accordance with their recommendations. Right.
Good.
And the white.
Okay.
I like the white, because it said bright snow white. But I don't, you know, I'll just pick another white. It doesn't matter.
Okay. So that's fine. You can those details you can work out with them.
Now, the thing with the meters, which was the only bone of contention that seemed to float around a little bit after, they actually agreed at the meeting that as long as we mitigated that with some type of screening, and, you know, that'll be something that we'll submit to them at some point, and they'll say yes or no, go back to the drawing board and design something else that we like, you know. So we're just, you know, we're going to be totally compliant and cooperative. That's basically it. You know?
So there's the electric meters are, rather than coming to the house, they are freestanding in the yard, and they're in they're identified on the plan with a circle with an E inside.
And I would like to say one more time, you know, the thing of it is there's things that people don't know, okay? Sylvia had one of her dogs stolen out of her backyard prior to any of this other stuff that happened to her and held for ransom for over how many months? So between all the things that have happened to Sylvia, honestly, my recommendation to her was keep your property in a way that you're in control of who comes close to your house and who isn't. And I think with all the traffic there and the new things that are going on there, the rail trail there, you know, you don't want to live in an armed fort, but you can do things to make it so that if somebody's walking up to your house and you didn't invite them, you're recognizing that.
You know, that's what I mean?
I
understand. I mean, so since you brought that up, we'll talk about it very briefly, because our jurisdiction is not so much that. But as I said in an email to you, I suspect, for what it's worth at this point, the meters are in, so we're not changing that. But just as another level, I suspect the meters that Central Hudson will actually install will be remote read meters, because that is what they're doing these days. They're trying to move towards that for their own reasons. And the second thing is, you know, you may well decide, and you might want to talk to the Historic Preservation Commission about this. You might want to put up a substantial hedgerow along the eastern edge of your property. It affords you much more privacy, and you know that.
I was thinking, well, I'm allowed to have a 6-foot fence.
But you know, you could put up evergreen type trees or shrubs that would.
Well,
provide you.
Fence, because I have two puppies.
No, that's fine. Right.
Well, my fence, I don't like to have a white picket fence anyway. I like to have a kind of fence that you can't see.
So anyway, I just as a suggestion. Okay, so you are scheduled for a public hearing in front of the Historic Preservation Commission later this month. I think May 16th. And so the main things of concern to us tonight are the site plan, the use of the building, and so those are the things that I want to make sure we talk about. But first, I want to open it up to any questions that other people have. No, you're good? Rich?
I mean, I missed one meeting. So how do we wind up with a parking lot in the front yard?
Right, so we need to discuss the
parking lot. I have a real problem with the parking lot in the front yard.
So let me interject here. You and I had discussed, and actually at our last planning board meeting, mm-hmm. we had talked about reducing the curb cut.
Right.
To
16 feet.
To 16 feet.
Which and, we did.
No, as shown on the plan, it's over 20 feet.
Oh, well, we can, that's fine. We'll make it 16 feet.
Okay, but we need, so yeah. the,
it was supposed to be 16 feet.
Is that what you're trying to do?
No, let me see what we did. That was supposed to be 16 feet.
Yeah, I didn't bring my ruler with me. But.
Okay. But scaled, or you mean it didn't scale out properly? Is that
no? I'm assuming that I have to assume that the drawing's to scale. It has a scale on it.
Right, because I did ask him to make that 16 feet.
Well, you have an apron that goes out.
All right, so is that like against the zoning or
no?
All right, well, I think my engineer probably felt that was more
okay
usable. You know what I mean?
So the thing
not to make somebody go like doot, but
no,
have
that's
a little
fine. Okay.
I mean, like, I run over the curb when I go into Grand Union, what is it, to ShopRite from the side street because it's okay. not a good curb, you know? So I think that's just a practical thing, not because we wanted more space.
Okay. So I, know. However, what we do have is we still have yeah. a pretty substantial parking area. And I think,
And I just want to comment at this yeah. juncture that was more or less what we discussed when I was here before. So yeah. that there would be room to back a car up if you had, we discussed having three cars in there.
Yeah.
Okay. So someone would have to show me how we could have three cars in there and turn them around without two, you know what I mean? One person goes out to move their car, there's three cars parked there. How do we back a car up and pull out forward?
What about putting the parking in the rear of the yard?
It's wet. The yard is not a yard where you would do that without spending
that
as much money as you did to build the house. It's wet back there.
I mean,
it's wet, Sylvia. You're talking thousands and thousands of dollars that you don't have.
We need to, I think part of the thing is that we need to make sure that the finished site is that it's a residential house with mm-hmm. a driveway that isn't much more substantial than you would have for a regular driveway for a regular house.
Well, the one across the street is pretty wide.
The one with the carport.
Mm-hmm.
But it's also an apartment building.
Well, you know, at some point, I mean, so again, these things are just things that I know it has no bearing, but it's just something to throw out there as a perspective. You know, I ask you all to imagine what the atmosphere surrounding Sylvia's house really is, okay? It is apartments. It's not privately owned homes with the owner in residence. And now we're going to have this giant building out on, right, that's what Sylvia's going to look at from the front room of her house, you know? So I understand your concerns, but I think we have to take it in context of the reality of what is there, what the atmosphere is, you know? It's not up the street where the stone houses are. It's a place that's subjected to a whole lot more activity by people other than the people that own the homes. So
we don't have as much design freedom as you might think.
Okay.
We are restricted to a code and mm-hmm. Following that code as much as we can. Where we can't make it fit, the ZBA then would come into it. So if you can't make the parking, I'd have to go back into the zoning and check with the zoning again, but I believe the parking has to be behind the facade of the building.
Not for a residential house,
but there's a business there with it.
No. I think you have to provide parking behind the facade of the house. No, whether that's in a garage or that's most people park in their driveway. We know that's the reality of it.
Right.
But I'm just saying what the code says, and this is far beyond a residential driveway.
I know, which is what I would like to try to scale it back in a way.
Well, I mean, I'm open to suggestions. When I sat down and tried to figure out the actual practical situation of, okay,
three cars are in there, one has to back up and get out.
Mm-hmm. So my...
So the business handles three people at a time?
Well, he figured two for the house, one for the business, actually.
See, I work alone. I don't work alone.
Yeah, no, that's, and that, we're not, so...
I've been there 20 years, so one client, you're two of us.
Yeah, I mean, let's be clear. Mm-hmm. We're not, this is not a business commercial application. This is a residential, single-family home application with an incidental use. And one of the things that we need to make sure is clear on the site plan is that that is what you're, what we're looking to approve.
What, do you want us to call it multi-use?
No. Yeah. No, if you do... Well, if you do do that, then everything changes and not, that's going to make your life much more difficult.
Okay,
no,
well,
no, let's do, I mean, that's fine. It's,
no, let's work on it. I mean, so, I'm up for working on it, but I don't see how you could put it behind the house.
No, and I'm not sure that that's even required. Are you clear? Are you certain about that?
No, that's what I'm saying. I'm not certain about it.
Because I don't, okay, that didn't.
I have it on the video.
But I'm pretty sure about it.
Okay, well, let's look into that, because I.
Anybody certain about it? Dave, what do you got
Dave's
there?
Looking it up.
You can park in the setback, but you can't have the setback for parking.
Well, the setback here is for, what is it? Wait a minute. Let's
my
talk about that.
Is when I'm
it's for
yeah.
the non-conforming lot?
I'm not...
Right.
Yeah.
And what is that, the setback for the pre-existing non-conforming?
But the proposal is to put parking here, not... I think we can cut this parking lot down substantially. I mean, we.
What is the setback for the pre-existing non-conforming lot?
I don't have that answer in front of me.
I have it.
Okay.
I'm 15.
On the front, I'm not so sure about that.
Is 25.
Yeah, that's what I think, which is what you put here. Do you have an answer?
Well,
I used to be right on the street.
Yeah, no,
I wasn't lost it. Involved in those the dialogue regarding establishment of setback with this property earlier on. So that's
no. We're just asking what the code says.
With and are we talking about with the use that experienced the fire for the
no? We're just asking. Party. We're just asking for a single family residential home. Mm-hmm. What the requirement is for where you can park your cars.
Do you have to provide parking behind the facade of the house?
Does that mean side yard parking or backyard parking?
Facade of the house, the front of the house.
All right,
the front line
so
the
level line.
Multiple.
Across the, right.
Fill their garage with junk and park in the driveway.
Or don't have
like
a
like mine.
Or don't have a garage.
But if you're going to build a new house by today's code, you'd have to show that the parking wasn't.
Okay.
It's what keeps us from keeping college students parked all over the front yard.
Okay.
Well, if we put
that.
The if we put the parking on the side, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So then we'd have to stay. What's the side setback on the
you
pre-existing?
Have it here. Eight. You have 8 feet.
Okay. So there would be room for three cars on the side of the house.
Over here, sure.
Okay.
We keep it behind the front of the house, sure.
Yeah. I mean, so if you did that...
Or not.
Indeed, here, go ahead.
Or not.
And you,
okay.
Well, there's a lot more room where androgyny used to be. So
yeah.
No, I know. Right, you're building...
So all that is
okay, so we've got one car parked here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay? It's... I'd have to see what that measurement is. I don't have a scale ruler with
me.
Yeah,
I don't either.
Okay. But, you know, that's the only place that you could really pick up the parking. Because if you went any further back than that, now you're talking about land that's not stable in wet, truly wet weather.
Yeah, I don't,
so,
I think that...
Well, I don't know if people know, but I am like the storm drain of Human Street.
Yeah, well, I know.
And all this point, and all the water comes to me.
Right,
right.
And I'm the one that's responsible.
But I also want
to,
you know, yeah. I also want to know for the legal aspect of it, okay, if this, there's a 25-foot setback line here, right?
Yep.
Okay. So if the law says that you can't park in front of the house, that's irrelevant to this discussion. But if the law does not say that you can't park in front of the house, then the only thing that we have to do to be in compliance is to be behind the 25-foot.
And I don't.
And I think your parking standards are 212.43 F and G 1. 212.43 F is residential driveways. Residential properties, not including apartment complexes, are permitted to have a driveway which shall not exceed 18 feet in width and not cover more than 30% of the lot frontage. Driveways on lots having frontage in excess of 90 feet shall not encroach on side yard setbacks and location of parking.